Welcome to New Human Conversations. This is Dr. John Ryan, your host, and I'm very excited to have two exceptional guests in this broadcast, Robert Coxon and Lilly Wong. Robert is a maestro, a musical composer and musician extraordinaire. He is Canada's best-selling New Age artist. Robert has produced 9 albums over 30 years and has performed concerts around the world to catalyze healing and transformation. His music has been scientifically proven to heal certain ailments, and numerous concert participants have reported miraculous healings. Lilly is the creator of the lithogram, the horusgram, and soul movement, and has supported numerous people around the world in living their divine purpose and creating true wealth. Today, as a channel, Lilly downloads groundbreaking tools that activate and integrate high universal frequencies that assist in ascension and the co-creation of a new world. Robert and Lilly travel the world today, bringing their healing message and profound work to audiences around the globe. So welcome to Lilly and Robert.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
So let's just get started by asking you both to take a minute, perhaps, just to introduce yourselves to the listening audience and to let them know a little bit about who you are and what you'd like to share.
Well, we're here in Mexico as we talk to you because we're working on a new program and music and light language. And
you're probably going to hear sometimes some background noises because we're in this small little town. So you're going to hear dogs, or you might always see chickens or something. Very beautiful trucks that they're selling everything from bread to milk, and they always come by and they sing, you know, like bye bye. So you might hear all the
we're going to make us hungry.
yourself and then myself, or
what should I say about me? And I think John said it. I'm a composer, and this is what I do. And down here, I'm in a place called the Magic Valley. And you cannot see it in this camera here, but behind us, there's these big rugged cliffs that go around like two-thirds behind me, like a horseshoe. And it's just magic here to be doing the writing that I do to help people heal and just feel wonderful. That's what it's all about. That's definitely what it's all about. We've been down here too, also giving online live streaming workshop, and we decided to stay and work on the show.
And there's something like when we before we met, so everybody both of us were in I call it spiritual path, you know, you can call it different ways. Mm-hmm. And on my own path of what I call the path of remembering rather than awakening, because it's like every time I remember a little bit more of who I am.
Exactly.
And part of the remembering is when I tap into something from within that it's called light language. And I was, and it came to me in when I say I would love to have some tools and remember some tools where that process can be sustained a bit more profound, mm-hmm. and at the same time we can release any kind of limitations or resistance, conscious and unconscious. I want to also be able to expand into more and more of who I am, like with no limitations. So this is how I start remember light language. Mm-hmm. And the more I remember and the more I share with others or I guide others into discovering from within what they have, the more I can grasp that light language and put it into a lilithgram, as you mentioned, or a horusgram, as you mentioned, and be able to guide others in to awaken or remember their full potential and what I call the full soul potential, that it goes beyond our imagination. And what happened when I met him is like, I consider myself to be a catalyze. You know, it's just like something that happens, and if something needs to come out, it's gonna come out. And Robert, I see it's an amplifier. So when both of us come together, it's a bit like boom.
And I really think since I met Lilly and got introduced to reintroduced to light language, I should say, my music has become more powerful, much more powerful. And it hasn't just stayed in that area of where people think, oh, Robert Coxon writes slow, relaxing music. Because it's expanded to even when I wrote the music six seasons of How It's Made program on Discovery Channel, I used the light language for every piece that I wrote, because I knew that that music was going out to the general public, that, you know, that shops at Walmart and all those other places, just the general public, but I could put something in the music that would help them to sort of start feeling the light and changing within themselves. Mm-hmm. So I've been using this light language in everything I do.
I love the concept of remembering rather than awakening, because it's true. We're already complete. Exactly. We're just pulling back together all the bits and pieces.
Yeah. Exactly. Yes. And what it helps is also like to get rid of whatever layer it's not permitting us to remember.
Yeah.
And it does not go just from this life. It goes like, okay, where is it from all the realities, from all like time in the no time? Where is not allowing me to remember who I am, or who more can I be? You know, it's like to discover. Well, it's like a constant evolution of yourself.
And it's helping us to tap into that reality of us being multidimensional beings, and not just living in a 3D world, but also we're missing so much of the power if we're just thinking 3D.
Yeah.
It's like we are completing a puzzle.
Yeah.
That's how I feel. It's like every time I can harmonize something that it does affect me in this life at some level. And I might know it consciously or unconsciously, but when I tap into that and I can harmonize it, I feel like when it's harmonized, it's really literally coming to me like, and then, whoa, I say, whoa, now I become, that's what I see there about the expansion. It's like, then I become a little bit more wide somehow. And I can reach more, but I can at the same time enjoy a lot more being on earth, enjoying my daily life.
Right, I understand.
For me, it's like, I start feeling more and more that I am part of that whole universe, but also I am my own universe within that universe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Like a fractal in a hologram.
Exactly.
So Lilly, just for our listeners who are perhaps new to some kind of information, use the term light language. Can you help our listeners understand a little bit what light language actually is?
Yes. And it's very interesting, because the other day I had this image of how to explain it the best. And I said, oh, I love it. You know,
we're really well timed to have this interview.
I love it. And the thing is, like, if you can, how do we communicate between humans? It's through language here, right? And most of the time it's more this part which is active. It's like, I remember some words, I remember the language, and this is how I communicate with others. It started being a bit more complicated when the person does speak, like in this case, English, for example. Mm-hmm. And we get a bit more complicated, so we get a little bit more creative with the hands and eyes, you know, or drawing things. But then you have other consciousness in the world, like you have animals, and then you have also trees.
And rocks.
And then you could go a little bit beyond, and then you can also go like inside Mother Earth, and you can start going a little bit beyond, and say, okay, you have some Vedic world beings, you know, so you have fairies, you have gnomes, or you have angels, or you have archangels. It's like, then you go beyond, and then you go to the Pleiadians, Orions, or you can even go beyond to say, well, there's a galaxy, or there's another universe. And I ask what are we all together? What does it make us, like you say, one with everything?
What is the common communication that we can have?
So what is the common, what are we? And I said, well, we are consciousness, right? We are vibration, we are energy, we are light. What do we need to be able to communicate? And not just, it's like from the both sides, you know, like when it's really communication, when it can go, it's not just one person, like we talking with the tree, but when we can allow also the tree talking with us, when we allow also angels talking with us, or we allow a galaxy, or we allow the DNA talking with us, or we allow one layer of DNA or one cell of our body, one innate. So we are all light. So the light language is there, of course, when it's light, we are light. So we need light language. And light language is just a way of vibrational way of communication, an universal way of communication with the whole. And the way I manifest.
Direct communication through light.
Absolutely. Okay. And the three ways to manifest it, or the way I've manifested, is one is the sound, which is for me is like the frequency, right? So it's and you might have it, which is I can say you one word, which is unimaneo or etenea, you know, that's one vibration which is limited. It's not, it has so many meanings because it's so unlimited and so multidimensional. And then you have the other one, which is the most tangible one, which is the one with matter, when you have it in form and color. And these are the sacred codes. So you can have it in cards, or you have like drawings, but it's still that vibration that communicates us, like where is this communication? And the third one, which is the most, the least tangible, is the movement, what I call soul movement, because it's how you get in communication with them. And if a tree's talking to you, then you allow just to receive that vibration and your body gets in touch with it. The hands move a lot, the eyes move a lot. And what it does is it changed the structure, the energy structure of things, so they can, so the light can still flow in a very harmonic way. And that is the package of light language together. And as I said, then you have someone like Robert Music, which it's the only person that I know that with the music can go exactly to all the places I told you, with the fairies, with Orion, with the galaxies. Take, like, okay, what do you want to tell us? So he goes and take that and bring it back in an amazing harmonious music.
Wow.
In the combination, as I said before, it's like it's something that's going to be catalyzed, but at the same time amplified. Mm-hmm. And this is how the things work together.
That's exactly. Beautiful. Because I've been present at some of your programs and participated in them. And I can feel what you're saying. Like there's a blend of coding and language that comes through the symbols, it comes through the colors, it comes through the designs and patterns, and also through the movement, and then the toning, the sound that's conveyed, layered by the music. And the music is also so profound because it's like a carrier. It's a, you know, like a substrate, if you will, that just kind of carries you along with the whole process. On that note, Robert, your music is beautiful, and I think many of our listeners will have heard some of it, the CDs that you've produced and the songs that you've made over the years. And I often share a story about, there's this song, Island Path, that I was listening to in the car, and I'm driving along, and I didn't know you, I didn't know your music or anything at the time, and I'm driving along the highway, the Autoroute 40 in Montreal, and all of a sudden I burst into tears, I had to pull over on the side of the road, and I had cry out this emotion that was so deep in my body, and I didn't even know where it was coming from. No conscious memory or tragedy that I associated with the food, but it was this deep, deep feeling that I had. And I really felt like I connected with home. Like it's the words that I would put on the experience. It was a very profound and beautiful moment for me. And I know a lot of people have experienced music in this way, but maybe just share with us a little about the relationship, music and healing, and how you see the kind of interface between these.
Wow, you talk about The Silent Path. That was such a powerful album for me. And when I was writing it, I knew I was doing the right thing, but my guides, if you want to call them, would not explain to me the significance of each piece on that album in the healing process or in the process of going on your path, because it's the silent path. And I remember a week after the thing was all recorded and ready to go into the stores, you know, it was all manufactured, just ready to go into the stores next week. And I went for a long walk late at night by myself. And then they fed me all this information of why each piece should be there in that, on that album. And it was so, wow. And I know that if they had told me that beforehand, I might have been influenced in the wrong way. Mm-hmm. You know, I would have tried to make it a certain way instead of letting it just, the music pour out. And the very most powerful healing pieces that I've ever so-called written are the ones that just come through and I don't change anything. I may take the piece and orchestrate it, you know, and add, like, write it for symphony or something instead of just piano, but I don't mess around and try to tweak it. It's just there. And those are the pieces that when I'm in the studio actually mixing an album, the ones that really pop out at me, the most powerful ones, I can actually sit there and say, wow, where did that come from? I didn't write that. It directly came from heaven. Wow. Or wherever, you know, wherever that is. Mm-hmm. And those are the ones with the magic. And those are the ones that people tell me, wow, you know, I had cancer and it disappeared by listening to that album. Or I had something else, or, you know, those are the obvious physical healings, which we even see when we are either giving a workshop or I'm doing a concert on stage and people are, you know, I've had people jump up and say, I've been healed, you know, it's almost like, I want to crawl under the piano, you know, because I don't want it to sound like an evangelical Sunday morning thing where they hit your forehead.
That's the vision I'm having in my head.
Yeah. But what the music is really doing is opening you up to see who you really are, yourself, because the music is not going to do the healing. The music is going to bring you to that place where you decide, do I claim this for me? Is this who I really am? Am I the healthy person? Am I the master?
It's a self-healing process.
It's a self-healing process, and the music is the catalyst. Mm-hmm. And it's, I think more and more the music is opening up people to their multidimensional selves so that you do it on all levels. And in other words, you're going to the source of why you have that challenge in your life, and you're healing, you're changing the source, fixing up at the source and not fixing it up on the surface. You know, you can get rid of some disease, but if you don't get rid of the source, the disease will come back again.
Right.
Most of the time.
Yeah.
So it's clearing you out. And like you said, coming home. Coming home to what? Coming home to who you really are, recognizing the real you. That's where your home is. Mm-hmm. And your home is in your own heaven.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I understand completely. Like it, I remember that. I'll never forget that experience. It was so profound. And it was literally like I touched the truth. And I knew it was.
Exactly. You touched your real truth.
Exactly who I was. And it was.
That you were probably on some level trying to remember. Mm-hmm. So you know, when we're trying to get something done, we tend to draw the tools to us.
Yeah.
That'll help us to remember who we really are. That's what healing's all about, is remembering who you really are.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. And yeah, an experience like that really helps you cognize, because there's so many words that try to describe this process. In some ways, they're so intangible and kind of fluffy in a way. It feels like, you know, we're talking in circles around something. You can't quite get into the core or the matrix of what it is. Do you have a moment like that and you feel the beauty inside yourself, see the light inside yourself, and you know it's exactly really who you are and where you come from. And then once you feel it and know it, you can't unknow it. Like,
absolutely not.
It's there forever. Like you're forever printed by that, and it affects you for the rest of your life.
And this is, I think, both of the work, and either when we do it individually or when we do it together, it's to bring you to an experience.
Okay.
So it's less about, I always said, and some people get a little bit shocked, I said, don't believe what I tell you.
Yeah.
Go and experience it.
Yeah.
So we are here to bring you that experience, because I'm in the belief that if you only believe the theory of it, you're prisoner of the knowledge of someone. But if you experience, you tap into your own wisdom. And then you can start living your wisdom. Yeah.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
And that's the difference between believing and knowing.
Yeah.
If someone's telling you something, you can believe them. But if you have the experience, you know. You're not just believing.
And
something.
There's nothing that's going to be able to tell you that's not, because you experience it.
Yeah.
So okay. Right. Right. I have not, but I know it. I mean, I might not be able to communicate or express what it is, but I know it is.
Yeah.
It's true. I mean, it's an exceptional time for people, because so many people are having unusual experiences, having visionary moments. They're feeling things that they don't understand, yet they know are somehow profound and real for them. And we're all learning. It's like we're babies in a way. We're stepping into the new world and we're having experiences that are guiding us. But what you say is very profound, because you can read all you want and you know, learn things which are helpful in lots of ways. But there's nothing like a moment of experience. It undoes all the words. It's become unnecessary.
Absolutely. And it's just sometimes exactly as you said, when there's some explanation, sometimes it's just the energy that helps to really integrate the experience.
Right.
So it's like, okay, I don't understand what happened. And I can say, well, this is what happened. And suddenly it's like the full information comes in and it's in, and then the knowing is there. Mm. So it is, we bring people into the experience, but if in that experience is still missing something, this is what I call it. I give a little bit of theory, and not to learn it, but it helps to shape it and to integrate the experience.
And I think that's necessary. Like, I think when you're approaching something new, you can't just create the experience, you know, all of a sudden, but you can prepare your mind. You can learn, you know, be fed enough information so your mind is able to grasp.
Exactly.
And then you get to have your own experience. So they go hand in hand, I think, really. Now, I've known Robert for quite some time, and Lily, I've known you now for several years as well. But since the two of you have been working together, you've mentioned this before, there's been a shift, there's been a change in the energy of the work and the profundity of the work. And I just want to read something that Lee Carroll had given once in a channel. He says, "You are the lineage of the masters. The two of you together have exponentially increased your effect on each other. The music that you put forward, Robert, has a new impact on people. And when Lily puts her light language to the music, everything explodes and the field itself starts to vibrate differently. It's not something the planet has seen before." Those are pretty profound words.
They sure are.
How does that touch you? Like, what's been your experience of that as that information has been shared with you?
Well, for me is, you know, sometimes you start doing a lot of things and you know there's something new, but your mind cannot grasp it. When there's this kind, first of all, it's in a confirmation. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you just read it again and my body just got goosebumps.
Yeah.
You know, it's because for me, this kind of information also implies responsibility.
Yeah.
Of what we're sharing, and a responsibility of keep evolving myself so that new information can come through me. Mm-hmm. So it's a combination. It's exciting. It's a combination of, yes, I'm not crazy.
You know? Which is very reassuring, isn't it?
Yes. Yes. And at the same time, yes, I want to do it. And how can I keep my vibration? What do I need to do so keep my vibration elevating and transforming so I can still be the vessel and manifest that new information? So that's for me what happens when I hear those words.
It's sort of a first reaction to be, wow, overwhelming. Like when the first times I heard that my music was part of someone getting this massive healing, whoa. And when Lee Carroll brings Cryon through saying this, it's sure it's confirmation, but it's also, wow. It's the realization even more profoundly for me that what I'm doing is sacred. Mm-hmm. I'm not just diddling on the piano. It's all those scales I played as a kid, you know, to practice for years and years. Mm-hmm. They're worth even more than ever thought they would be. It wasn't just to have fun. We talk about playing music, you know. We never talk about working the piano. We play the piano.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. And
at the same time, it's a bit of a joke because actually when we met, as we had both our experiences, Earth experience with other partners, we said we're never going to work together. Okay, so it was like kind of the
last words.
but when he's playing music and I'm doing light language all the time in the house, it got together. Okay. With that, like even the dance, it was suddenly I was there, and then someone said, "Come, you come too." Like it got very, very together. So when I hear that, it's also for me like kind of like a joke from the universe, you know. It's like, yeah, it was gonna come that naturally. And when we finally kind of allow it a lot more, that happens together. For me too, it's like every time I experience it, I could feel the vibration in myself. Mm-hmm. So it's like, yes, I mean, this is something absolutely extremely extraordinary for myself. Mm-hmm. And of course, in that, I'm a person that whenever I experience something that it's amazing for myself, I wanna share it with others. It's like, come, like experience this.
Yeah.
And so that I have that sensation also with Cryon saying that, like, yeah, you see?
Well, the thing about Lilly, once we started living together, the main titled piece of our show that we're in the process of producing right now, Be You, Be Love, that piece actually came from Lilly walking into my studio and saying some light language. She was channeling light language, and as she's channeling it, this amazing melody is coming through.
Wow.
And then we worked on it, and we did our best to translate in a limited way what that light language meant. And it was all about being you and being love. It was all about love and how you're love, I'm love. And if I am you, then I can see me, and, you know, we're all one.
Yeah.
And it came amazing piece, but only because Lilly was doing this light language, and it just, they sent everything through then, you know. And
that's so beautiful.
Going to be a big show.
So this is a new show that you're building now?
Yes.
Can you tell us about it, or is it too soon?
No.
It's actually too, it's very soon, the premiere.
Oh, awesome. So maybe take
a while. And you know, a lot of people have heard the piece Be You, Be Love, because we've been doing it at some of the events throughout the world and testing it. And we did it. We have actually a recording of it with 1,000 people singing it in Hungary. Really? Hungarians who don't speak English, but they could sing the words to this song, you know?
They can sing in light.
Yeah. And we've been working on it with, you know, with...
It's a team. We have a team.
Yeah, we have a whole team on it.
Wow. We have a celestial or entourage team, and we have a very good
team. Multidimensional.
Yeah. And we'll have real virtual soul violinists with us and percussionists. And
but what I say is, like, it's like I would say, take a pause and listen to the silence of just being. And we're going to take you in the show in a journey. It's an inner journey while you're going to enjoy music, dance, film, and experience. That's for me, Bejubel Love. And a beautiful journey that allow you to stop, breathe, and enjoy.
Wow.
But it's...
I can feel it as you speak.
Just a journey, a musical journey that anyone can appreciate. It's not something that we're doing for the New Age community or that we're doing for those who meditate or those who feel they're enlightened already.
We're receiving information of what is this about, and I was just receiving, because this is something we can share here, because that's the kind of community, right? It's like a very strong vibration. And they said, but this is going to go, just going to be a show. Mm-hmm. Whoever wants to come resonate. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, I say, whoa, it's time of the whole remembering of everybody, because this is going to come someone, it's going to enjoy a beautiful show, and something is going to shift in them. That's why for me, it's a beautiful journey. It's going to be a lot of healing. It's going to be a lot of remembering. It's going to be, and the idea is, it's going to be for everybody. It's like, it's the time. It's actually the mm-hmm. like, if we see how all the things that happen in the world, is the perfect timing for this. It's time so we can all cleanse and harmonize whatever we need to do, mm-hmm. even if you're not conscious about it.
Right.
But you're so ready for it.
Yeah. It's interesting what you say, because I mean, it is time for a much larger scale. We can call it whatever we want, I mean, in terms of language, but the heart opening, the experience of people connecting with their spiritual truth, the divinity within them, and feeling it, knowing it, it's the essence of who they are. And I think music is so incredible that way, and all of the arts, the dance, the movement, the symbols, the visuals, all of these things touch you in a way, it cuts right through all the talk, and it allows you to feel and to have this experience we were talking about earlier. And so I think it's a beautiful way to reach people and to let them have their own moment, you know, something that it becomes personal to them.
It's a show. It's not a concert, it's a show, but there won't be any talking.
Which is a shock for Robert. Because on this, we are co-creating with his daughter, Tia. Okay. And from the beginning, we all the time, he say, and then I could say something, and Tia and I, no, Robert, it's not going to be a talking here.
You're going to have to rein him in.
Yeah. And then the artistic director, Veronique, so we were three women, again, came into the play, and it was the same. But I could say something like this, and we were like, no, Robert.
Just play.
No talking in this. It's really taking in a journey.
There's some acting. But no talking.
It's going to be a bit more light language. And for me, more than acting, it's, we're going to also tap in that energy that we're experiencing and allow the others to feel it through us.
Yeah.
And of course, my daughter Tia is a cinematographer. She just came back from Kilimanjaro. That's one of our roosters.
They're announcing your new show.
Yeah, she was doing a documentary on climbing Kilimanjaro.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so we have some of that footage that might be in the concert.
Oh, and that's lovely.
And the butterflies, the monarch butterflies that we went to see the other day on top of this gigantic mountain, that was amazing. you know, all these Canadian butterflies flittering around us, but we're in Mexico, you know, in the winter.
And the thing is,
you're going to make all the Canadians jealous because we're here fighting winter now.
Oh, no. Well, we're bringing the show soon.
Yeah, we're bringing in a hot show.
On the 13th of April.
Yeah, 13th of April, which is a magical Thursday.
Okay.
And it's actually going to be held at Canada's oldest theater.
Really?
It's a beautiful place. It looks like an opera house. Wow. It's the Monument National in Montreal. It's on St. Lawrence and René Lévesque, but a beautiful place, beautiful place.
And you know, like every time we go to do filming or something, we end up, and this is where I always have this, this is something that it's completely sustained from the universe. Because for example, in the now that we went and filmed to the Monarchs, they allow us to go dancing, or they allow me to go dancing to a place that they don't take any other people.
Okay.
And it has happened, but many times when I film me dancing, mm-hmm. there's someone there that say, okay, come. And
come to the special place.
Yes.
Wink, wink.
Yes. So that's for me always a confirmation, because I don't even need to ask. I don't go and ask, and you gave me a place, they always tell us, no, come, we're going to take you to that place.
Oh,
so
amazing.
It's like, okay, yeah. This is so beautiful. Yes.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Co-creating.
So we want everyone to bring all their friends.
Made in the announcement.
So people will be able to access information on your website, I'm sure, eh?
Yes,
that'll be up. It's not up yet.
Not up yet? Okay.
It'll be up next week.
With the interview at the bottom, I'll post a link to both of your websites so people.
Okay, thank you. Thanks so much.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Now, when you're talking, I was having a visual because a lot of things I receive in information are visual. I'll get geometry and I'll see things like templates and things. And as you're talking, I'm seeing this massive, very complex, beautiful geometry of light that's kind of descending to part of the experience. So I'm kind of seeing in energy what you're creating in terms of an experience. And it's beautiful. Like it's this pattern of interdimensional energy, like a big sunburst, but it's full of color and all kinds of different smaller geometries within this massive geometrical.
He must be seeing the first piece.
No. He's seen the whole. I can absolutely resonate
definitely.
With what
that's
you're
what
saying.
It, yeah, definitely.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's interesting because I can see it almost coming in like a structure, like a ship, a pattern of energy that forms, and it's sitting with the people as they are living this moment.
Yes.
And it's the resonance of that energy and vibration that's strong and powerful. I think to help people feel. That's amazing.
Yeah. Nice. Love it. Because that's how I see it too. It's just beautiful.
Oh, that's cool. That's awesome. Now, we also have an event coming up together at the end of the year.
Yay! Yeah, that's really, that's exciting.
So we'll be together in Hawaii in December, the Return to Lemuria conference. And this will be Carol and Cryon. And Amber Wolf and of the Lemurian Sisterhood. And it's a very inspired conference. It's the information that I was given in creating this is that it's trying to activate the consciousness, the deep memory that we held while we were living in Lemurian times. Mm-hmm. And I just want to open that up to you guys to share what you feel or think about this event, because we're all very connected on a soul level. So I just know that.
We were in Hawaii this last, just before Christmas, preparing our energy for next year.
Awesome.
It's wow, you know. And when we're thinking of Lemuria, just a flash came into my mind. I remember channeling Lemurian music on a Cryon cruise the first time we were doing a Hawaiian cruise, going by one of the islands, the one where they did Jurassic Park. And we're
by
going
Kauai. I think that was by Kauai.
I was channeling the music through, and it's very much like a piece on the silent path. Very interestingly. I think the piece is called The Path. It's very Lemurian energy.
Yeah. Well, I think it's very exciting because a lot of our remembering also has been remembering times Lemuria, Atlantis, and a lot of what we do. Okay, I love what we do.
Is that the ice cream truck?
What we do is exactly the reactivation. Part of the light language and the music we do is exactly to go and see where something dormant, where something that needs to be, what is the time, and we shake it a little bit so it comes up. So we definitely feel that's part of our being there and in that event that you're so kind to co-create, like creating and put it for us in a such a beautiful way.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. We feel honored to be there with you.
Oh, that's awesome. I feel the same way. So
it's gonna be super.
Yeah, it's really it's gonna be a remarkable event. I just know it.
They tell us also something about the Elohim, that it's going to be also some Elohim, something new, that it's going to be also from our part. For that event, it's going to be something special.
Yes.
Brilliant.
Yes. We're not going to tell you yet.
We're not yet either.
They have not given you all.
They just tell us something about the Elohims is something that we haven't shared before.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing. That's amazing. I can, because I see the Elohim as the builders of form. And I know that when this event was being triggered, like when I started to first receive information about it, and before I even brought it to Lee or to, you know, the attention of the Crinon group, and I was starting to get a stimulus to want to do this. And what I knew was, we talk about building the new Jerusalem. You know, we all know it's not a place. It's a state of consciousness. It's a state of consciousness that we know from before. And it's rebirthing that consciousness into our modern day beings, if you will.
Exactly. Yes.
And the seed of that, I think, I really believe, lies in that time, in that experience, in the Lemurian experience. As this energy comes alive within us, we're catalyzing and triggering a tremendous awakening.
Yes.
And ability to carry an energy and a presence that it'll change the lives of everybody who is part of it, for sure, but it'll extend very far through the energy that it contains.
Yes, and definitely.
Lots and lots of people around the world. So, I feel very, very honored and so grateful that you guys are part of it.
Yeah, it's good.
We're very happy about it.
And we'll have a lot of magic to offer.
Awesome. Yeah, I know. That's awesome. So, well, we're pretty much at the end of an hour here. We don't want to keep people too long on their internet. But maybe just before we close down, is there anything you'd like to share, a final comment or last words for the listeners who are listening today?
I'm going to share you one light language word, which I think is very beautiful, which is etenea. And etenea is something that goes beyond thank you. It's thank you for everything. Thank you, I'm humble. Thank you, I have gratitude for the comfortable, uncomfortable. Thank you, I take responsibility of myself. Thank you, I co-creating more. I'm allowing the universe and the abundance to me. Thank you, bring me more, as Alcazar says. It's like all that together.
Yes.
It's etenea. So for me, it's also honoring of you, of all the ones that are listening, honoring myself. It's a big, goes beyond thank you for me. So there's something I can I want to share with you, but I can recommend you, everybody can start using. Because whenever you have something and then you start repeating, something start to change.
Right.
And it's giving the universe the permission to help you move forward.
Mm-hmm. It's
to raise your vibration.
Mm-hmm. So that's how I would like to end, like saying etenea.
Me too.
Well, I can't think of a better way to close our interview than that. That's really, really beautiful. So from my heart, thank you both very, very much. Sure. Yeah. You both. And thanks very much for sharing of yourselves, for the time and for the people who are listening today. It means a lot.
Beautiful.
Thanks so much.
God bless you.
Thank you.